an 8 original production.
Books and Company is made possible by the Virginia G. Piper Center for Creative Writing, serving writers and readers in the Phoenix metropolitan area, the state of Arizona, and the world.
Welcome to Books and Company. Bienvenidos todos. I'm your host, Alberto Rios, and we're joined today by Dina Nayeri talking about her book, A Teaspoon of Earth and Sea, published by Riverhead Books. Welcome, Dina.
Thank you for having me.
Well, I'm excited to talk about this book. I think it has enormity and complexity, but it's predicated on simple things, and that's what makes it a lot of fun to read. Difficult to read as well. Well, this is a book about Iran, mm-hmm. and about a woman, a young woman in Iran, and about women in general in Iran, and maybe just, we could say, women.
Yes.
Now, as writers, we're faced with the adage, write what you know. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about what brought you to writing a book about Iran.
Oh, wow. Well, as you say, I know the women in Iran very well because I was raised by so many different kinds of them and spent 8 years.
You were born in Iran.
Yes, I was born in Iran and I lived in Isfahan and often stayed in a tiny little village about 30 minutes outside of Isfahan where my father grew up. Mm-hmm. So,
is that in the north?
Isfahan? No, that's not. Tehran's in the north, Isfahan's okay. Further south. And this village was just a completely different landscape than any of the Iranian cities that, you know, I guess people see, but, and it was just like going back in time, and it was essentially run by these women who were just so different and strong and interesting, just fascinating women, and I guess the book is filled with them. So in that sense, I wrote what I knew because I used so many of my own experiences from home and so many of, you know, the stories and the characters and all of the little tidbits that I carried back with me to the U.S., but in many ways, it was something I didn't know because I've been out of Iran for, mm-hmm. you know, so many years, for more than 20 years. And so I had to do a lot of research. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, it was a whole new world.
Well, those women play quite an important role in the book. Mm-hmm. And the main character, we watch her growing up, so we follow her life. And mm-hmm. she is born a twin.
Yes.
And that becomes important in the book. But her mother goes missing. Mm-hmm. And so we see her raised without a mother. But she has these women to whom she refers as mothers, her
yes.
mothers. And they have all sorts of things to say to her. There are some difficulties, and I want to get to those. But you also have some wonderful parts about just living a civilized life
mm-hmm.
and how the world works in the small village.
Mm-hmm.
And you have some wonderful words like mastmali.
Uh-huh.
Can you tell us about what mastmali and maybe tarof and
sure.
yogurt?
Actually, you've gotten right to some of my favorite things about this this book and about Iranian culture. One of the most interesting things to me about Iranian culture is their relationship with truth and lies and storytelling. Mm-hmm. Iranians love stories, and it's just woven in every part of the culture.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, whether you're at a dinner party or with friends, people are always weaving tales and bringing up old stories. It's a very human thing, not so much an Iranian thing. But the relationship to lies is particularly Iranian because there's several kinds of lies that are completely sanctioned and accepted by society, and people use them in everyday life. And these are two of them. I call them in the book, you know, two of the Persian arts. Tarof is one people know very well,
okay.
and it is the art of, you know, kind of this polite lying. One of the biggest examples is, you know, when someone offers you something. Let's say if I offered you, you know, a plate of cookies or something, you would have to refuse it three times.
Oh, refuse it?
Yes.
You don't just simply say, I love these cookies.
No. You say, no, three times. No, thank you. I don't want any. You know, I'm full. Whatever it takes. But if you actually want it, you only accept on the third time. And then if you truly don't want it, then you refuse all three times and the person knows not to
okay.
go on. But if the person actually doesn't want to offer something, they still have to offer because they know you'll refuse three times. So then they just don't offer again on the third time. So this people often do when they invite you to dinner. They say, oh, please come this Friday. And you say, oh, no, I couldn't. And they say, oh, please do. And you say, oh, no, I couldn't possibly. And then they stop. That means it wasn't a real invitation.
That's great.
Yeah, and you know.
And this happens in the marketplace as well.
Yeah.
It's not just in homes or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it extends to, you know, people, when you offer to pay for a service or right. for something you've bought, people often say, oh, no, it's yours. Mm-hmm. They don't mean that, of course. Mm-hmm. They're just supposed to say it once, and that's taruf. Mm-hmm. It's polite, and it's a lie, but it's something everyone has to do, and they have to learn how to do it well.
Mm-hmm. It was hard for me to distinguish a little bit whether, in the case of the family here, they have some wealth. Mm-hmm. And so when Saba, mm-hmm. the main character, goes into the marketplace to buy something, the person says, no, it's yours.
Yes, yes. And the person is very poor, and he still does. It's pride. It's okay. It's part of the culture. You don't just take money, and mm-hmm. You are often pretending that you don't have needs that you have, and people mm-hmm. are supposed to see. People are supposed to be much more, I guess, clever and astute and see through things, but you're not supposed to come out and confess that you have a need. The community is supposed to come and, you know, mm-hmm. rally around you in that way. It's part of the culture. And Masmali is another thing
okay.
that is very interesting. That it literally translates to rubbing with yogurt.
Ah,
you know, so
okay.
mast is yogurt, okay. and it means to rub something with yogurt, and that's when you push something under the rug. So that's a little bit of a pretend innocence, where something happens, or let's say there's some uncomfortable topic, and instead of addressing it, you rub it with yogurt so that it can be white and you don't have to actually deal with the truth of it.
Okay, which allows everybody to move forward.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Okay. There's, you have, just to take that a little bit further, you also have this wonderful moment in which you describe the chirping talk of the Persian mothers. this it's not a lullaby, it's actual conversation. Mm-hmm. You characterize it as why, how, what, chera, chetor, chi.
Yes.
Chirp, chirp, chirp.
Yes. And to me, it sounds like chirping.
Yeah, no. And I think anybody, especially a child, gets that. Mm-hmm. You don't always understand the vocabulary of the language, but you hear the sound.
Yeah.
And to characterize it, I really enjoyed that particular
Thank you. It's just, if for some reason, you know, those words all, I guess for the same reason that they all start with the WH in English, they start with the chir. And so when people talk fast, it does sound very much like a chirping. I enjoy it.
Okay. Well, now I've mentioned the main character, who is Saba Hafesi.
Hafesi, yes.
Hafesi. And she is the twin to Matab, who she refers to constantly, though I think she becomes absent as we move through the book. We are in a search for her. She imagines that she has gone with her mother to America, so mm-hmm. that's a big part of the book. But even with these civilized, what I call civilizing sort of structures in place, there's a lot of fear. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of fear that things get done, quote unquote, right. Mm-hmm. And to the extent that there's even a moral police, mm-hmm. right? Can you talk a little bit about the pasdars and the akhounds and the mullahs?
Sure. Well, you know, in Iran after the revolution, mm-hmm.
And that's a very important milestone, isn't
yes.
it? We need to really
talk
about that. Yeah.
Well, you know, in 1979, Iran went through a revolution, and then after that, Khomeini returned, and the Shah was ousted, and you know, then the Islamic Republic was put into place, and the world of women became a lot more strict, because now this was an Islamic Republic, and an Islamic state required that you wear hijab. It's, you know, often just a what they call a rusari, which is a scarf around the neck, and then coverings from head to toe that are not, you know, form fitting, mm-hmm. Or sometimes in certain places, you know, places of worship or offices, you know, a big long black chador. Mm-hmm. So
you mentioned black; they need to be modest
dark.
In color.
Yes,
dark.
Yes, dark. Modest in every way, wearing, you know, makeup or nail polish, things like that, or anything too showy was no longer allowed. And then there was a moral police who would go around and enforce this. So life became much more difficult for women. The universities became Islamic. And, you know, then the war happened, and there was rationing of food and a lot of other things mm-hmm. that affected day-to-day life. But the moral police, I think, was one of the biggest things, because they then governed your everyday life and, mm-hmm. You know, would actually take it upon themselves to say, no, you're not covered enough, so you have to, you know, push your scarf forward a little, or why are you wearing makeup, or why are you wearing, you know, this color or that style.
But these pasdars, they're still often quite young men.
Yes.
And they're all men.
Yes. Well, they're
women do some of the work of enforcing.
Yes.
But it seems to be the men that are and they're young, and so there's the wonderful line, and it's a very difficult line, that one of the quote-unquote mothers to Saba says, that a beautiful woman always seems to have broken a rule.
Yeah. Well, and I mean, it's very much, I guess it's an opinion, and it's mm-hmm. mine, because, you know, these are young men, and a lot of them aren't all that educated and not completely in control of, you know, their own urges, or mm-hmm. and it's a very, very confusing, you know, sudden change. In 1979, suddenly all the rules are different, everything is a sin, and these very young men.
For women.
For women and for men, too.
For men, too, okay.
So these young men are in charge of enforcing all this, but at the same time, they're living a very repressed life, mm-hmm. and you know, I guess they have their own self-loathing that's going on, and there's a lot of human things that that conflict with a lot of the rules and ones that they're charged with enforcing. And so in the book, there's moments where those things clash in very horrible ways. I find it really very interesting, because so many of the people put in charge of enforcing things for the Islamic Republic, are so young and so kind of, I guess, newly given this power.
And so young to wield it.
Yes, exactly.
I'd like to just take a moment to remind our viewers that you're watching Books and Company. I'm your host, Alberto Rios, and we're joined today by Dina Nayari, who's talking about her book, A Teaspoon of Earth and Sea. Well, this idea of the fear factor, what's interesting to me is the different coping mechanisms you have for it. Some of those are these little, you know, little slight breakings of the rules, mm-hmm. like somebody painting their fingernails, mm-hmm. or wearing high heels, which becomes, you know, these all become important in the plot. But you also have a little bit of something else going on that I would characterize basically as lists. Mm-hmm. You have these different lists of things. And one of the things is you have an immigrant worries list, which we'll, maybe we can talk about what we're imagining the other twin to be having in America. Mm-hmm. But you also have, and these are reflective, because they're, in both cases, people in America are imagining back. Mm-hmm. On Iran, but it is Sabat projecting herself as being in America also, who,
yes,
who creates these lists, like what it is to be an Iranian, mm-hmm. right? She does that with Cameron, I think it is.
Yes, the imagined, one of the Mahtab
right,
stories, yeah.
In one of the Mahtab stories. What do you think of somebody reading a list like that? Are these...
Well, which, any of those you mean?
Yeah, any of them.
Well, I
particularly like the immigrant worries lists.
Thank you.
Because I think they're true to any immigrant group.
I think so. I actually was a little worried about putting that one in, because it was, this is supposed to be through Saba's filter, and
right.
she hasn't been an immigrant yet. So I tried to make them as universal as possible, mm-hmm. so that someone could imagine what it would be like to just be an mm-hmm. outsider. But I think the lists really... are so much about my own personality and a part of my personality that seems to have transferred to Saba, which mm-hmm. is, you know, the list making and the fretting mm-hmm. and the worrying and the trying to make sense of the world in that
That's
way.
That's what it is, trying to make sense,
yeah.
isn't it? Ordering it in some fashion and understanding its elements.
Exactly,
right.
exactly. And I think the list that you mentioned with Cameron, where it's Saba imagining her sister Mahtab in America, you know, meeting an Iranian American man, and they are making a list of how to be authentic Persians.
Right.
And I think that's it has been an interesting question for me, but it's one of those things where you try to make sense of an entire world, an yeah. entire culture and country, just through these little elements that you can maybe put together. The way Saba, for example, puts together English words to try right. to make herself feel, you know, Western, or of course, these are just tiny elements of an entire universe that they don't have access to. So,
but it's their life now, right?
Yes.
And they're half a world away from Iran. You use the word Persian.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Can you describe or tell us a little bit about that? The use of the word Persia and the word Iran?
Persia, I mean, is a much older word, the right. Persian Empire, and it's, I guess, what we refer to the Iranian people. A lot of people attach some political meaning to one versus another. I mean, to me, Iran is the name of the country. It doesn't at all reflect, you know, just the Iran of since 1979, which some people call themselves Persian instead of Iranian because they're much, much more proud of the thousands of years old culture and, you know, history and literature and all the wonderful things that has come out of there, and they don't want to necessarily associate themselves with the current Iran. But Iran is a much, much older word, and it's just the country, you know. For me personally, they're interchangeable.
Well, in the midst of all of this fear and these pasdars and the moral police, there's still all of this budding sensuousness. And there's a wonderful moment where you have Sabah and Reza.
Reza, yes.
Where they're in the pantry. And I don't know if their friend Pune is there as well. But you have this line, she thinks of his feet in the pantry. the two of them barefoot and slightly drunk in the dark, daring only to feel each other's toes. It's a wonderful, wonderful, very sweet moment.
Thank you.
And it is the far end of sensuousness. Do you know what I mean? It's just...
Yeah, it's the very least, I guess.
And can you say a little bit more about that? I mean, there you have all of these small little vibrations happening under the hijab, you know, all of this stuff going on. And little ways to have them sort of show themselves. And that was a very sweet... a moment where they're finding their way.
Right. Well, I mean, I think it's two things. First, I wanted, you know, some universal element of, you know, that kind of coming of age where everything takes on such monumental meaning and everything is so exciting and new and just so much as, you know, the movement of someone's toes or the heat of their fingers is, is just, you know, blissful and exciting. But so in that sense, I guess I was, you know, very much using my own experience as much as, you know, what I've learned about Iran through research. But then on the other hand, a lot of the people I talk to who, you know, lived in their teenage years in post-revolutionary Iran talk about how, because so much is restricted, every little thing takes on significance, and there is there are those little moments between people that mean so much more than they would to us here because we have them so much more often. And and to me, that was just really lovely, the secret of nature of everything, and then how you can carry something small like that with you for a very, very long time and relive it over and over because maybe that you won't get it again very soon.
And so it becomes precious.
Yes.
Much like, and I think one of the recurring themes here is the wonderful, just everywhere sense, well, maybe it's just Sabah, you will tell me right now, of media, music in particular. But videotapes and just different ways, and often American, they all seem to be American. And then references to what they would do in America via these videotapes and sitcoms and stuff like Alex Keaton and and so on, you know, as if those were the, you know, the ways to live life here. But, but she thinks they, well, she, I think she knows better, but she nevertheless uses them as good exemplars of how Americans do it.
Yes, yes, that's true. I have to admit that I took a few too many life lessons from Alex Keaton. Why did I do that? I don't know.
Well, you talk about an obsession with university that he...
Exactly, that he had in that show. Yeah. But I think, you know, when you are first discovering a culture and you're, let's say, for me personally, I'm not talking about Sabah, but when you come to a country and you are 10 years behind everyone else and you have to learn the whole culture, sometimes you rely on things like television and music and magazines. And so that's what I have Sabah doing. She wants to learn about America. She's fascinated with this culture and this is the best way to understand it. And, you know, in reality, after the revolution, lots of American media still got smuggled into Iran through these video men who would come with their briefcases door to door and you know, trade videos from home to home. And often...
Was this dangerous?
Very. But, you know, it was black market, just like a lot of other black market things out there. But the interesting thing was that often the videos were marked or mislabeled, or, you know, the person would pretend they have some knowledge of the videos that they didn't actually have. So, you know, they would, you know, bring some sort of, you know, old Bollywood tape and claim that it's a Michael Jackson music video. And then you would watch it and realize that's not what it is. So, you know, I was trying to tap into that a little. But the the music obsession.
Yeah.
For me was particularly, I guess, poignant because I started, while I was writing this book, to have an obsession with Iranian music.
Wow.
Yeah, and so okay. I started to just devour it the way Saba devours American music. And so I tried to show a little bit of that because the way I listen to Iranian music is so different from the way Iranians listen to Iranian music. Yeah. You know, for me, it's just this, you know, I have it available to me, of course, lots yeah. and lots of it, but it still feels like a lost thing that I have, you know, there's a disconnect between me and that world, and there's a particular gap that will never be closed because I didn't grow up there and have that experience. And, you know, whatever I can get on Spotify is pretty much the best I can do.
You're showing
to
us the reverse of that in Saba.
The whole thing is the reverse of that because, you know, for me, I wrote this book about a girl in Iran just through research about Iran and through my own obsession with Iran. Mm-hmm. And she does that with her sister, you know, makes up stories about Mahtab.
Fast Car is a song that keeps coming up, by the way. There are some favorites, too, which is interesting because you it's not just generic music or whatever. Mm-hmm. There are some favorites, and what's wonderful is to see what anybody in any village anywhere on earth would do is try to start making them your own. So Reza starts playing it on his father's sitar.
Yeah.
And there's the wonderful line that he can make anything sound 1,000 years old.
Yes.
That's a wonderful cultural statement, isn't it? Here's this new song being made to sound
so old. It's one of the instruments. When I was in Amsterdam, I discovered this quartet of string musicians that would play old Turkish and Iranian instruments, and everything sounded so old and beautiful, even things they had just written. So I kind of imagined how wonderful it would be to play some of the new songs like that.
Okay. Well, in mixing this old and new culture and worldviews, really, you also say something quite interesting. You have one of the characters say, "They are a logical race, these Westerners. They don't have spirits and body parts floating around in everyday life." And you also make other mentions of, for example, I think evil eye or jealous eye and some things like that.
Yes,
that's old world, but.
Very. I mean, there's a lot of superstition in Iranian culture. It's just back to the whole relationship with truth and lies. I mean, Iranians have such an imagination and have such a sense of, you know, stories and the old world and spirits and mysteries and all of these things. I mean, much of them are universal, but I feel like Americans are a much more logical culture. And, you know, Iranians take all of these parts with them in their everyday life, and they use it to give advice and to make decisions.
So they make use, they make it into something. It doesn't just stay on the periphery.
Yeah, it's part of the culture.
Okay. Well, let me ask you if there have been any repercussions to writing this book, because you divulge what feels like, to an outsider, some secrets of how daily life gets lived and how you circumvent some of the more stringent laws and all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. Have there been any kind of reactions of that sort?
For me personally?
Well, I don't know, you know, for you, for the book, for...
No, not yet. I mean, the book only, I guess, as we're speaking now, only came out about a week or so ago. Mm-hmm. So not yet, but I guess I'm looking forward to seeing.
Well, you have also such a wonderful sort of aspiration that Saba has, and she gives it to Mahtab of going to university, which I mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. But you have this wonderful characterization of university as a father, Baba Harvard, and it can only be Harvard because of Alex P. Keaton.
Noah, he wanted to go to Princeton.
Oh, he wanted? Did he really?
Yes.
And
yes,
okay. But you use Harvard in the book.
Yes.
And it seems like no other university will do.
Sorry. Go ahead.
No, it made me laugh, and I think you make good use of that and good focus. But the idea of Baba Harvard is you have this wonderful line: only Baba Harvard can keep his children from driving a taxi or collecting garbage.
This is very much a reflection of the way I thought when I first arrived in America. For me, I mean, I arrived in the U.S. with my mother and brother, and my father wasn't there, and I was very close to him. So the fatherlessness of my adolescence was kind of, I guess, one of the biggest factors that, you know, one of the biggest aspects of it. And when I went to Princeton for undergrad, and it felt so much like a surrogate father. Like the first time I went into one of the offices, and you know, they gave me a check for my tuition, and then a check for my expenses, and then they, you know, there was all of this just this entire system built to help your life, you know, be just in full control, to run, you know, so well, so you can just study. It felt completely new and interesting, and very, you know, father-like to me. And I guess that is the purpose of a university. Mm-hmm. But yeah.
I'm glad to hear it worked out and that it helped to give us this book.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
You've been watching Books and Company. I'm your host, Alberto Rios. We've been joined today by Dina Nayari, talking about A Teaspoon of Earth and Sea. Please join us again next time when we will bring you another good book.
Books and Company is made possible by the Virginia G. Piper Center for Creative Writing, serving writers and readers in the Phoenix metropolitan area, the state of Arizona, and the world.